أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما، اللهم آمين. اللهم اهدنا لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك، إنك تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. So alhamdulillah, you've heard the vast majority of the shubuhat, alhamdulillah. And this lecture, a very short lecture inshallah ta'ala, is dedicated to the shubuhat and the misconceptions and doubts that the ghulat and the mumayya, they spread. And before we begin the shubhat, we need to first understand what exactly is a shubha. So firstly, the word shubha or shubuhat is a word that has been mentioned in the sharia. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, from the hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir, قَالَ سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنٌ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنٌ وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ وَمَنْ وَقَعَ فِي الشُّبُهَاتِ وَقَعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ. So the Prophet ﷺ, in this hadith, he says, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنٌ, that those things that are halal are clear cut, are clear. That halal is clear. وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيْنَ, and haram is also clear. The masail, the issues of haram are also clear. But between them are doubtful matters. لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ, many people do not know the rulings pertaining to these doubtful matters. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَغَدِ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ. So whoever creates a barrier between himself and these shubuhat, whoever stays away from these doubtful matters, then this person has protected his religion and his honor. استبرأ لدينه وعرضه. ومن وقع في الشبهات, and whoever falls into shubuhat, وقع في الحرام, falls into haram. So الشبهات, the word الشبهات is the plural for الشبهة, and the أصل of شبهة is from الشبه أو الشبيه. So shubha comes from ash-shabah wa shabih, two things that are similar to each other. Very difficult to differentiate between them, to distinguish between them. It's called a shubha. Or mathalan, two people who look like each other. You say mathalan, hadha shabihun bihadha, hadha rajul shabihun bihadha. This person looks like this other person. And a shubha too, the essence of a shubha is al-iltibasu, and it's things that cause confusion, things that cause doubt. So a shubha is a person who has the haqq, mathalan. So a shubha can enter into a person's heart, a person who's upon the haqq, causing him to doubt the haqq, causing him to have misconceptions about the haqq, or change his view. طيب. So that's the context that a shubha is used. So a shubha, mathalan, is used upon a person who is upon the haqq, the truth, and something comes to cause him to doubt the truth that he or she is upon. So that's what a shubha means. So a shubha isn't a person who's upon batil and misguidance, like a takfir or a khariji, and then the haq and the ra and the huquq and the haq and the truth is recited onto this person, causing him to doubt his viewpoint, causing his, in his eyes, maybe it could be considered a shubha in his eyes, but in the eyes of the sharia, that's not considered a shubha. That's considered this person being told the haq. So when we talk about shubha, we're talking about a person who has the haq, and then something comes to try to cause him to doubt the haq that they are upon. And the opposite of a shubha is al-manhaj. Why? Because al-manhaju, the word manhaj, is al-wuduh or al-wadih, al-tariq al-wadih. The essence of manhaj is the tariq that is wadih. Something that's clear-cut is mada manhaj, wadih. That's what the word actually means, al-manhaj. And manhaj also means adamul ghumud. It means something that has no ambiguity in it. So when we say, so that's why the Salafi is a person who is upon the manhaj of the Salaf al-Salih, meaning that this person is someone who is upon the haqq and this person's his manhaj and his aqeedah and everything that is that the word manhaj entails is clear cut. There is no ambiguity. And in the Quran, as we've previously covered, there is muhkam and mutashabih. We won't go into that again. Allah Azza wa Jal, go back to the ayah in Surah Al Imran, ayah number 7. هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات محكمات هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات. Go back to the ayah, Tafsir Ibn Kathir, Tafsir Al-Sa'di, to find out the meaning between the, يعني what muhkam and mutashabih means. And we also learned that أهل السنة والجماعة, they يردون المتشابه إلى المحكم. They return everything that is a mutashabih to the muhkamat. Whereas the people of dalal and misguidance, they return everything that is mutashabih, everything that is, they return the muhkamat to the mutashabih. They take up something that's muhkam and they understand it and return it back to something, a shubha that they have. And also Ahlul Zayghi wal Dalal, as you know, the first thing they do is they have their aqeedah and then they look for a dalil. So firstly, they have an aqeedah, they believe in something. Then when they believe in something, they look for evidence to support whatever false ideology that they have. Whereas the people of the Sunnah, first they look for the Dalil, and then they have the Aqeedah, which is based upon the Dalil. Okay? Al-Manhaju also, Ikhwani, Istilahan. So we've covered what Manhaj means linguistically. Manhaj, Shar'an and Istilahan, Sheikh Muhammad Aman Al-Jami, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, he says, المنهج, he says, هو الطريق الواضح الذي سار عليه المسلمون الأولون في دينهم عقيدة وشريعة وسلوكا وأخلاقا وجميع نواحي الحياة. So he says that the manhaj is a طريق الواضح. It is a path that is clear cut, the path that the first Muslims took in their religion, meaning the Salaf. In their religion, في دينهم, عقيدة, a manhaj that covers عقيدة, شريعة, a manhaj that covers the whole of the شريعة, سلوك, a manhaj that covers يعني their سلوك and the way they conduct their day-to-day lives, أخلاقا, a manhaj that their manhaj in their etiquette and mannerisms, وجميع نواحي الحياة, and in every aspect of their lives. So from this ta'rif and definition, we understand that manhaj, ikhwani al-fudala, that manhaj is all-encompassing. Manhaj encompasses every aspect of Islam. Okay? So after covering this, let's cover the shubhat one by one. So the first shubha, okay, is they say, يَجِبُ أَن نَتَعَاوَن مَعَ جَمِيعِ النَّاسِ فِي الْبِرِّ وَنَدْعَ مَا عِنْدَهُم مِّن مُخَالَفَاتِ لِأَنَّ الْهَدَفُ وَاحِدْ وَالْخَوْضُ فِي مَسَائِلِ الْخِلَافِ قَدْ يُسَبِّبُ فِتْنَةً وَنُفُورًا لِبَعْضِ النَّاسِ عَنِ الْحَقِّ. They say that it's obligatory and compulsory for us to cooperate with one another, okay? Because Allah commands us, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. We have to cooperate with each other, okay? That's the first shubha. So, and then they say, another shubha they say, and وَنَدْعُوا, يعني we should abandon and leave these people that we're cooperating with, we should ignore, and all of the يعني مخالفات that they have, all of the مخالفات and their opposition to the Sunnah, we should ignore it. لأن الهدف واحد, because our objective is one. We all want the same thing at the end of the day, so we shouldn't look too deeply into their مخالفات. And then they say, the third shubha is, they say that الخوض في مسائل الخلاف قد يسبب فتنة. They say that delving and engaging and talking about these مسائل الخلاف, these مسائل of خلاف, is going to cause fitna. So they say, so again, this is an ambiguous statement. All of this is ambiguous. So the first, let's go back to the first shubha. طيب, from what you've learned, you know that this sentence contains حق and باطل. You know this. You've already covered this. So when they say that it's obligatory for us to cooperate with everyone upon birr, okay, there is haq and batil. The haq is sahih, we should cooperate with each other, but we should cooperate with the people of the sunnah. And what do they mean by cooperate? ما قصدهم من التعاون? What is the maqsad من التعاون? طيب, so do we co-op, for example, a mubtadi', an innovator, okay? He wants us to cooperate with him in his bid'ah. Do we cooperate with him? Diobandi says to you, I want you to come and teach يعني that the fact that it's okay to make tawaf around the qubur, cooperate with me. Okay? Because this is part of Islam. Are you going to cooperate with him? No. Okay? A takfiri comes to you and says to you, let's go demonstrate and protest and shout some silly slogans. Do that, come. Because we cooperate with one another. So again, هذا كلام, of course, لا يسوق ولا يجوز وهذا كلام باطل. Also, the الأدلة تدل على عدم التعاون مع أهل البدع. All of these evidences that we've read, that you've known in the previous lecture, the one before that, all of these evidences tell us that the Aqidah of Ahl al-Sunnah al-Jama'ah is that it's impermissible to cooperate with the people of innovation. This cooperation, يعني sharing platforms with them, يعني praising them, helping them and trying to aid them in their bid'ah, showing respect to them in any way, shape or form, any cooperation. That's the asl. That's ماذا? The asl. Jameel. Also, when they say that مسائل الخلاف, their version of مسائل الخلاف is مسائل العقيدة, by the way. So when they say that مسائل الخلاف is going to cause fitna, what they're saying is, speaking about matters of tawheed and shirk, عقيدة, all of these matters is going to cause fitna. I can't go to this masjid or that markaz and speak about these matters because that's going to cause fitna in the masjid. And we have been commanded in the Quran and the Sunnah to stay away from those things that cause fitna in the mujtama', in the community. طيب? So that's obviously kalam batil. So how can speaking about tawheed, warning against shirk, which is the role of the prophets and messengers, which is exactly what the prophets and messengers did, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهُ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ طيب? How can this cause fitna? How can the Quran cause fitna? How can the Sunnah cause fitna? The only fitna that's being caused is them. They are the ones causing the fitna. Because by not speaking about these matters and these issues, this is where the fitna is. In fact, Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ مَا الْفِتْنَةُ? What did Imam Ahmad say about this fitna? The fitna here is الْكُفْرُ وَالشِّرْكُ فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ يعني those who oppose the sunnah عن أمره يعني عن سنته. Those who oppose the sunnah, let they be warned, يعني let they be afraid that their opposition to the sunnah is going to cause them to fall into fitna. طيب? So opposing the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is what causes ماذا? Fitna. Also, when they say, يعني they say, نعم. They say that the يعني third shubha, they say that this causes ماذا? People to stay away. This is going to cause people to disperse from my da'wah. They may have, for example, certain number of followers. Okay? And they may, some of these people, subhanAllah, they even refer to their students or the people that take from them as followers, يعني subscribers, followers, يعني مصطلحات غير شرعية. طيب? So these people are afraid that by speaking about certain مخالفات شرعية, certain innovations and certain matters of عقيدة, inviting to these matters, they are afraid that this will cause a group from amongst their followers to stay away from them or to disperse away from them. And in some aspects, إخواني فيلا, in some parts, especially in the Western da'wah scene culture, there is no conflict of interest. There is a type of conflict of interest. Now, what's this conflict of interest is, if I am a da'i now, and my source of income, or my major source of income, is going to masajid and marakiz, and getting paid for giving lectures, which I'm not saying is wrong, and some du'at, they do deserve this. The du'at, they deserve some source of income, and this is a way for themselves to continue giving da'wah and at the same time يعني help the people and also helps them to continue teaching people, right? So the conflict of interest is that this person relies on those marakiz all over the Western world, all over the world or in the UK. He relies on them, okay? Every time he goes and gives a khutbah, يعني he gets some sort of salary or he gets a musa'ad or financial gain from it. Then what happens is that will cause that person, to, يعني if they don't fear Allah Azza wa Jal, and they don't have strength of character, strength of taqwa and adl and ilm, that this person now is going to, his da'wah is going to be aligned with every markaz that he goes to. Is going to be in sync with every markaz that he goes to. He will be like someone, they are going to use him like a remote control. Okay? Changing the channel, khalas. Everywhere he goes to, they are the ones that lay down the law and the agenda. Speak about these certain matters. Maybe they will say it explicitly. Maybe they will infer it. Maybe they will allude to it. But everyone knows the score. Okay? It's like the hidden rule. It's like the elephant in the room. You come to this masjid, right? We want to protest every day. We want to speak about the hukam. I don't want you talking about these matters. You can speak about fadail al-a'mal. Speak about these issues. As for these issues on the left, don't even talk about these issues. Otherwise, you're not coming back here. And that has happened, ikhwani fillah. A lot of some of these masajid, when they don't know you, I know this, ikhwani fillah, because when you come from Medina, they don't know who you are. So they want to test the waters. So they invite you. Okay, then they will know from how you speak. And what our ulama and scholars have taught us back in Medina is we speak the haqq, we go to a masjid. Mathalan, you go to a masjid, ma'rufun bi mukhalafati sunnah, that is known for disagreeing with the sunnah. طيب, what do you do? ماذا تفعل? You talk about ahamiyat al-sunnah, al-i'tisam bi-sunnah. طيب, so one of those masajid, you speak of one of these masajid, I spoke about the umur am, يعني كلام, it wasn't even refuting anyone. There was no refutation in it. It was just establishing the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah in certain masail, such as, for example, following the sunnah, staying away from bid'ah, things that you can find in a book in aqidah. No sooner do I finish the lecture, one of them says, "Akhi, you know, these issues, let's not talk about them. These issues, يعني, people can misunderstand them." Okay? The Mawlid al-Nabawi, this is mas'ala khilafiyah. There's a khilaf in the mas'ala. Let's stay away from this. Okay? Then obviously they'll never invite you again. So they will look for a da'i that conforms ماذا to their da'wah. And the ikhwan al-muslimin here, and many of these hizbiyin in the masajid, they pick and choose the du'a to confuse ماذا the young youth like yourself. So you have a markaz. They'll invite certain du'at salafiyin and they won't invite others. Okay? And you're thinking, why don't they invite others? Maybe there's something wrong with them. Maybe there's something wrong with this one. You don't know. So they will pick and choose and create a division amongst the Salafis based on matter who they invite and who they don't. So this is something that you need to be aware of. So when they say this shubha, like for example, khilaf, they say matter masail al-khilaf, qad tusabbib fitna. This is what they mean by masail al-khilaf. They mean by masail al-khilaf, you don't even need to go as far as talking about refutations. يعني, these masail and these issues have become so alien in the Western da'wah culture, issues of al-rad ala ahli al-bid'ah, al-rad ala al-mukhalif, that when someone speaks about these issues, it's like an elephant in the room. It's like these marakiz, they have created a culture, they have created a culture that the only issues that we can speak, that we can speak about, are issues of, for example, that they want you to speak about. So, مثلاً, فضائل الأعمال, there is nothing wrong with this. Of course, we need to speak about the خطورة الزنا, شرب الخمر, homosexuality, all of these ma'asi, we need to speak about them. But that's the only masail they want you to speak about. Anything to do with al-bid'atu wa sunnah, anything to do with firq, anything to do with al-rad ala al-mukhalif, even shirk, anwa' al-shirk, the different types of shirk, even dawabid al-takfir, speaking about the khawarij, يعني, these issues for them are masail al-khilaf. They don't want you going anywhere near these masail. The next shubha, ikhwani fillah, is that they say, number two, they say, لا يصلح الرد على المخالف في هذا الزمن. There's no hikmah when it comes to refuting anyone in this day and age, or refuting even bid'ah, forget ashkhas names, even innovations, there's no maslaha in it. And there's a lot of tikrar, ikhwani fillah. Lakin bit tikrari yathbutul ilm. You've heard all of this. But with tikrar, constant repetition, ماذا? Yathbutul ilm. Okay? So they say that there is no maslaha in refuting the opposer. And tasnifu nas, making tasnif. You know what tasnif means? يعني labeling people or labeling groups, there's no room for it in this day and age. There is no maslaha because Ahlul Bid'ah are many, and we need to give nasiha with gentleness and with rifq. Firstly, you've all heard that Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are all mujmi'un, unanimously agreed upon the fact that it is permissible, in fact obligatory, to refute the opposer, to speak about the people of innovation and refute them. In fact, this ijma' is mentioned in many books of Aqeedah. It's mentioned in Kitab al-Shari' al-Jurri. Al-Lalaka'i mentions it. Shaykh Islam Taymi mentions it. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions it. It's everywhere, subhanAllah. Simple evidence, is Hadith al-Iftiraq that you've heard. The Hadith where the Prophet ﷺ says that this Ummah will be divided into 73 sects. So the fact that the Ummah will be divided into 73 sects means that there are 73 sects. That means that there are 72 sects that are upon misguidance. So if they're upon misguidance, then who are these people? Are they khayalun la wujud lahum? Are they a figment of the Prophet's imagination? They don't even exist. Of course they exist. طيب. Also, ikhwani fillah, we know that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, from the hadith of in Ad-Darimi, the author of Ad-Darimi in his Sunan, hadith of Amr ibn Yahya, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he came to a people who were sitting in circles inside the masjid, and there was a man standing, and this man would say Subhanallah 100 times, and then they would say Subhanallah 100 times, say La ilaha illallah 100 times, and then they would say La ilaha illallah 100 times, say Allahu Akbar al hadith al athar, and then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, يعني ما هذا الذي أراكم تصنعون, what is this that you're doing, and then they said يا أبا عبد الله يا أبا عبد الرحمن حسن نعد به تكبيرة والتهليل والتسبيح. These are simply hasan, these are basically just pebbles that we're using to count the number of times we say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. And then he says, he said to them, Imma annakum ala millatin hiya ahda min millati Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, aw muftatihu bab al-dalala. Choose between the two. Either you are upon a religion that is more guided than the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or you're more guided than the Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or you have opened, or you're opening the doors of misguidance. You're opening the doors of misguidance. So choose between the two. And then they said, Ya Abu Abdurrahman, ma aradna illa al-khayr. We only wanted khayr. And then he said his famous words, Wa kam min muridin al-khayri lam yusibu. How many people who are looking for khayr are not, do not attain any good or any khayr? So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud here is refuting these people. He saw the munkar. Did he wait and say, listen, I need to wait for a bit. Let me give them gradual advice. Let me wait for a second. Continue giving them da'wah for a few months, a few years. And then I'll give them advice. Maybe they will die upon this bid'ah. How do you know? How can you be certain? Did he wait or did he give them da'wah and refute them there and then? He refuted them there and then. He advised them. Call it whatever you want. Advise, refutation. Al-Mihim, he told them the haq there and then. So that basically is another evidence. Also, ikhwani fillah, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha in Bukhari and Muslim, a woman came to her asking her about hayd. Should the ha'id, the woman on her menses, should she taqdi as-siyam wa salat? How should she make up for the missing months and missing days in Ramadan and salawat? What did Aisha say to her? Ahruriyatun anti? Are you a haruriyah? So that's labeling right there, tasnif. Aisha automatically, she looked at her and she made tasnif. She labeled her, are you a haruriyah? So that shows haruriyah, are you a kharijiyah? Also, the Salaf, they warned against the Azariqa. Nafi' ibn al-Azraq, who was a khariji, they warned against the Azariqa. Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, he says, may Allah curse the Azariqa. So that's labeling right there. The Sahaba, they labeled a certain group of people as mada? Azariqa. Also, the Salaf, they refuted Jahm ibn Safwan, who learned from Ja'd ibn al-Dirham. Ja'd ibn al-Dirham was not just refuted. What happened to him? Do you know what happened to Ja'd ibn al-Dirham? Naam. Ja'd ibn al-Dirham was slaughtered by Khalid al-Qasri. طيب. And Khalid al-Qasri, it was the Udhiyah. It was on Eid al-Adha. And Khalid al-Qasri, he was on the minbar dragging Ja'ad ibn al-Dirham. And he said, Ya ayyuhal nas, dhahu fa inni mudahhin bi Ja'ad ibn al-Dirham. Oh people, go and do your Udhiyah. For my Udhiyah, today is Ja'ad ibn al-Dirham. فإنه, and then he mentioned his مخالفات. Subhanallah, what bigger shidda is there than that? So إخواني في الله, the people of أهل السنة والجماعة were always متشد. يعني this is an أصل from من أصول الشريعة. جميل. Also the Abdullah ibn Umar and how he refuted the قدرية. معبد الجهني, غيلان الدمشقي. This is in صحيح مسلم. How Wasil ibn Ata al-Mu'tazili was also يعني refuted by the Ahl al-Sunnah, also Amr ibn Ubaid, وهكذا. And quick مسألة I want to quickly share with you, إخواني في الله. هل يجوز التصنيف بالظن؟ Now, the Mumayya, they will say, how do you know? This person hasn't explicitly said something. This person is this, only sits with the people of innovations. How do you know? Always creating doubts. So the question is, is a tasnif bil-dhanni jaiz? What's dhanni? يعني assumption. Tasnif, labeling someone based on assumption. Is this allowed? Now, assumption is divided into two. You have a dhan alladhi huwa shak. That's basically that dhan that is shak, doubt. This is not allowed. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, inna ba'da dhanni ithm. طيب? That's shak. So, labeling someone based on dhan, based on doubt, shak is ماذا? Is when something is 50-50. لا مزية لأحدهما عن الآخر. 50-50. طيب? So that basically is considered shak. This is not allowed. You can't have doubts. Because Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. Don't be suspicious of one another. Okay? So just because one of your brother, يعني you see someone who's known to be upon the sunnah, one day standing with a person who you know is the person of innovation, doesn't give you the right to make tabdi' of him, doesn't give you the right to label him by and with something derogatory be based on that particular scenario. It doesn't give you the right. Maybe that person was his father. Maybe it was his brother. Maybe it was it could be one, it could be 100 different reasons. طيب? So that's shak. As for ghalabatu dhan, dhan which is basically known as the overwhelming assumption, then this is the type of dhan that the Salaf used to label someone. So ghalabatu dhan is basically when a person, there is no certainty, but based on al-qara'in wal-adilla allati tahtaffu hawla hadhihi al-qadiyya, and based on the qara'in, the indicators, and based on evidences, external factors, many external factors, then you know that the Salaf would use that as mather an evidence to label someone as mather an innovator. The proof of this is مثلاً the statement of the Salaf where they would say من أخفى عنا بدعته لم تخفى علينا إلفته. يعني whoever hides from us his عقيدة, then he can't hide from us, he can't hide his companions from us. So they would use the fact that this person has companions from the people of innovation as an indicator to his aqeedah. So مثلاً, إخوان, this is basically غلبتُ الظن, right? There could be certain exceptions. And you've all heard the statements of the Salaf when it comes to the people of innovation. Now where they would say, يعني, if a person walks with an innovator after being advised, then he is also أَلْحِقْهُ بِهِ أَلْحِقْهُ بِهِ يعني, count him from amongst them. What they mean by that is that 99.9% of the time they are the same in aqeedah. So the, from tajriba at-tatabbu' wal-istiqra, يعني from by looking at this the situation the Salaf and by يعني from their experience they know that 99.9% of the time that is the case. طيب? However, there could be an exception. So the exception could be that if a person hypothetically speaking is upon the sunnah, upon the haq, which is rare, يعني if his companions are the people of innovation, this person upon the sunnah, okay? But he sees that this particular innovator is not an innovator in his eyes. There is a ta'wil sa'iq. This person has an interpretation or a ta'wil that is sa'iq, okay? And he doesn't believe what he believes in, okay? He doesn't even think he's an innovator, even after he's been told, right? He still has that ta'wil. But for example, if that person
who he's walking with is someone who has been accused, for example, of khuruj ala al-wulat, of rebelling against the rulers. Example. Okay? He yarat saif. And he has the opinion of a saif, rebelling against the rulers. Then this person, a sunni, is asked, is this your madhab? Do you anta tara saif? Do you believe in rebelling against the rulers? He says, no, la, 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 abadan, a'udhu billah. No, I don't believe in that. But your friend believes in it. No, he doesn't. I asked him yesterday and he doesn't. No, he does. No, he doesn't. See? Right? So he doesn't know. مَا يَدْرِي لَعَلَّهُ مَا سَمِعِ It could be... In this situation, this person is not removed from the fold of Islam. Okay? But that is rare. So when the Salaf, they're giving you these usul and these principles, what they're giving you is the غَلَبَةُ الظَّنِ. This is غَلَبَةُ الظَّنِ. The predominant assumption, the overwhelming assumption is that usually when someone walks with the people of innovation, hangs around with them, spends a lot of time with them, the reason for this is because people, birds of a feather, flock together. People matter, hang out with the people that they feel most comfortable with. And this person, he feels more comfortable with innovators, so most likely he's also an innovator. That's basically what this means. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his book At-Tadhkira or Tadhkiratul Huffaz, he mentions that the person who's labeling, okay, has to be a person of taqwa, has to be a person of wara', has to be a person of zuhd, a person who fears Allah Azza wa Jal. And he mentions, ikhwani fillah, so many different, so many shurut and conditions, it's very rare to find these conditions in one person. He says, mathalan, he says that this person who is labeling, he says, this person has to be someone who yudminu at-talab. This person, he has to be addicted to seeking knowledge, obsessed with seeking knowledge. Wal fahs and research regarding this issue that they're labeling. Wa kathratul mudhakara. This person has to be someone who's always revising, always seeking knowledge. Wa sahar, wa tayaqud. Someone who's known to staying awake at night. Someone who's known for fahm, tayaqud, has awareness, deep understanding, with taqwa, he says, with deen al-mateen, with a solid religion, wal insaf, and also someone who is munsif, someone who has adl and just, wal taraddud ila majalis al-ulama, someone who constantly goes to the sittings of the scholars, wal taharri wal itqan, someone who takes great care in precision, has precision and has mastery, and perfection in ilm. He says, if you are not like this, he says, listen to what he says, and he has to have wara', he says, فَإِنْ آنَسْتَ يَا هَذَا مِنْ نَفْسِكَ فَهْمًا وَصِدْقًا وَدِينًا وَرَعًا. If you find that you have fahm and you have deen and sidq, طيب, فَلَا تَتَعَيَّن. He says, then do not ماذا تَتَعَيَّن. Don't go into labeling people. Don't even go near this particular mas'ala issue. وَإِنْ غَلَبَ عَلَيْكَ الْهَوَى وَالْعَصَبِيَّةِ لِرَأْيٍ أَوْ مَذْهَبٍ فَبِاللَّهِ لَا تَتَعَيَّن. If you're someone who has desires, who has basically someone of desires, someone who has whose only aim is he has a personal vendetta or agenda against the person he's trying to label. This person has a personal vendetta, personal agenda, personal grudge. Maybe there's something between him and that person. He says, if that's the case, لا تتعين. Don't go into this issue. طيب. نعم. And he says, وَإِنْ عَرَفْتَ أَنَّكَ مُهْمِلٌ لِحُدُودِ اللَّهِ فَأَرِحْنَا مِنْكَ. If he says, if you're someone who has shortcomings in the limitations set by Allah, the boundaries set by Allah Azza wa Jal, then let us rest from your evil. Leave us alone. طيب. So when it comes to labeling people, إخوان في الله, the Salaf would take, يعني would be متشددون, would basically take great care to stay away from from labeling someone with batil, with falsehood, without haq. So that's basically the shubha. So that tells us, this shubha where they say we shouldn't label or we shouldn't go into labeling, the mumayyi'un, they take these types of aqwal nuqulat to cancel out labeling and leave off everything else. Whereas the mumayyi'un, they take the aqwal of the salaf, the athar of the salaf, that talk about or label certain innovators with certain labels, and then they go overboard with that and do have ghulu and exaggerate in that realm, and then they use that and place that upon the heads of the Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And both groups are wrong. Number three, the third shubha is التظاهر بالورع عند الكلام في أهل البدع والغضب الشديد. We covered this previously. يعني التظاهر بالورع, they pretend to have ورع. There's some people, they pretend to have ورع and they pretend to have يعني that they have taqwa and they fear Allah Azza wa Jal when it comes to speaking about certain innovations. So they hear someone speaking about an innovator or certain innovations and they have ورع. يا أخي لا ينبغي أن نتكلم في أعراض الناس, لا ينبغي أن نخوض في هذه المسائل, هذه أعراض الناس. These are, they, you know, it's not upon us to speak about the honor of people, to speak about these issues. It's not upon us, يعني we have to protect our tongue. We have to, يعني as if, mashallah, tabarakallah, the Salaf and all of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, none of them even, they are the first to find out from those nusus that they, that protecting your tongue is important. يعني is important. But everyone else has no wara, has no taqwa. And these people, subhanallah, يعني يغضبون, يعني they get, and subhanallah, the funny thing is, or the sad thing is, that they have wara and taqwa when it comes to speaking about the people of innovation. But as for the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, then it's open season. It's adi. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, damuhum wa a'raduhum halal lahum. Their honor is halal, they will lie about Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they will say things like these people are extremists, and they will have anger, they will show anger towards Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So they even contradict themselves. And we also, we know the author of Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash, when he was asked about who's a Sunni, he said he is the person when ahwa and desires are spoken about, he doesn't get angry. Shubha number four is they say that, you know, I can go to Ahlul Sunnah, يعني we can, let's take the good from every person and leave off that which is batil, that which is false. يعني it was covered, يعني just previously, Sheikh Saeed covered it, muwazanat. قضية الموازنات. So we'll take the good and leave of ماذا? The باطل. And قضية الموازنات إخواني في الله, this is something that يدندنون حوله. The مميعون, they يدندنون حوله. يعني this is something that they constantly repeat. Let's, يعني no sooner does someone speak about an innovator or an innovation, you hear them in the background saying, mention his good points as well. Be just. Ansif, mention his good points. So I'm going to quickly mention, just take some, summarize the statements of the mashayikh. Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz was asked about al-muwazanat, taking the good and leaving the batil, or when refuting someone, should we mention their good points? He says, the sheikh, he says that basically, he says, فأجاب الشيخ, he says, فيه أناس يوجبون الموازنة. يعني the questioner says there are people who say that موازنة is واجب. The Sheikh says لا, no, ما هو بلازم. It is not correct to speak to mention ماذا their good points when refuting the innovator. So when you're refuting the innovator by mentioning their good points, يعني كلام طويل, but مفاده is that they say that by mentioning their good points, يعني you are calling to them. You're praising this person. So what's the point of that? It defeats the purpose of warning against them, right? Imagine, subhanAllah, and none of the Salaf, when the Salaf were refuting the Jahm ibn Safwan, what did Al-Imam Ahmad say? And Jahm ibn Safwan, he was a good person. He was good to his mother. He was good to his parents. La, he didn't. They refuted him. وخلاص وبالله التوفيق. طيب, الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله تعالى also was asked. طيب. It's a long question, but he was asked about muwazanat. طيب, he says that the questioner says that some of our brothers, the shabab, they say, or they, it has been said to them, لا بد لمن أراد أن يتكلم في رجل مبتدع قد بان ابتداعه وحربه للسنة أو لم يكن كذلك لكنه أخطأ في مسائل تتصل بالمنهج لا يتكلم في ذلك أحد إلا من ذكر بقية حسناته. They say that when you're speaking about a مبتدع, an innovator, or someone who has مخالفات in the شريعة, when you speak, you have to mention some of his حسنات, some of his good deeds. And they name this قاعدة في الموازنات بين الحسنات والسيئات. طيب, the Sheikh, he says, the questioner says, can you make tafsil of this mas'ala? Can you mention the tafsil and mention this issue and talk about it in detail? The Sheikh responded, he says, I'll give you some detail here. He He says the detail and the tafsil is وَكُلُّ خَيْرٍ فِي اتِّبَاعِ مَنْ سَلَفْ وَهَلْ كَانَ السَّلَفُ يَفْعَلُونَ ذَلِكَ. He says every khayr is following the salaf. The question is, did the salaf do this? The answer is no. That's it. Did the salaf do this? When they were refuting the people of innovation, right? In many different places. Did they speak about their hasanat? Jahm Nasafwan, Amr ibn Ubaid, Bishr al-Marisi, Harith al-Muhasibi. Did they speak about their hasanat? Abadan, la. طيب. So that's Sheikh al-Albani, also Sheikh al-Hiyadan, and also there's some fatawa of also Sheikh Abdul Muhsin al-Abbad, and these fatawa are ma'rufa, alhamdulillah. So this is a mas'ala, it's very baffling, wallahi. يعني that our scholars spoke about this particular mas'ala 10, 15, 20 years ago. خلاص. Yet we find in this day and age, we find people still regurgitating the same nonsense. The same thing again and again. We should talk about the good things and leave off the bad things, now they say. Or we should talk about both of them. You should be munsif. You should have insaf. La, kayf al-insaf? Did Allah Azza wa Jal talk about Fir'aun when Allah was refuting Fir'aun? Did he mention Fir'aun in a good light? I'm sure Fir'aun had some good points. I'm sure he was he was good to his mother, right? Was that mentioned in the Quran? La, of course not. So these are things, inshallah, that we need to know. The next shubha is they say, and you also you heard also the issue of Imran al-Hattan. You all know Imran al-Hattan, how he married his cousin, and he actually wanted to guide her ila sunnah. She ended up guiding him to the to misguidance, to khuruj. Look at the dangers, يعني, of mixing with the people of innovation. Also, Ibn Aqil al-Hanbali, he said that the Hanabila used to stop me from attending or try to cause me not to attend some certain lessons. Okay? Some ulama and their certain lessons. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi said that the reason they stopped him was they were stopping him and trying to warn him against sitting with the Mu'tazila. Sitting again with who? The Mu'tazila. Subhanallah. And he became a Mu'tazili because of this. Because of ماذا? Sitting with the Mu'tazila. And you've heard from Sheikh Sa'id, يعني, the issue, how Abu Dharr al-Harawi became a leader and a ra's, inviting to the Asha'ira, the madhab of the Ash'ariyah, because of Dar Qutni and how he praised al-Baqillani. يعني. So this is the danger. The next mas'ala is, they say, why don't you speak about the people of sins? Why don't you speak about Ahlul Khumur, the people who drink alcohol? Why don't you speak about the Fusaq, يعني, these people who commit all sorts of ma'asi? And why are you speaking about these other people, يعني, meaning the people of innovation? Ibn al-Qayyim, he mentions in al-Madarij, he mentions that al-ma'asi, that bid'ah, innovations are worse matter than ma'asi, are worse than ma'asi. The next shubha, number six, is they say, so-and-so, this person, يعني, is someone who عَالِمٌ وَوَاعِظٌ وَقَدْ انْتَفَعَ النَّاسُ بِهِ وَهُوَ زَاهِدٌ. Why are you speaking about this particular person? He is a alim. He is someone who's a scholar. He is a zahid. People benefit from him. Why are you speaking about this book? People benefit from this book. طيب. So, this is the shubha. This qari, مثلاً. This particular qari, wallahi, people listen to him all the time. He has a beautiful voice when it comes to reciting the Quran. طيب. Doesn't matter if he's a tablighi. Doesn't matter if he's a sufi. Doesn't matter if he says that we should rebel against the rulers. People benefit from him. So the maslaha, the greater good, is to leave off speaking about him, because that's the greater good. This is the shubha that they have. So these people, the mi'yar and the measurement of whether a person is upon the haqq or not, or the measurement of is ماذا الانتفاعُ, is ماذا on how much you can benefit from ماذا, from that particular person or that particular book. Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentions that there is benefit in khamr and maysir, أليس كذلك؟ وإثمهما أكبر من نفعهما. يسألونك عن الخمر والميسر قل فيهما إثم كبير ومنافع للناس. Allah mentions that الخمر and maysir, there is منافع, there is some benefit. But that benefit, does that mean that because khamr and maysir, there is benefit in it, that we can take, we can drink alcohol and go gamble? Of course not. It's haram. طيب. Also, I'm going to give you two examples of two innovators whom the Salaf classed and labeled as innovators, who both were people of knowledge and people of zuhd. The first is Amr ibn Ubaid, Abu Uthman al-Basri al-Mu'tazili. طيب. He was a zahid and he was a alim. He was someone who had some knowledge, and he was someone who had zuhd. يعني. طيب. He wasn't someone who was running around the dunya. طيب. Now, his knowledge was recognized by the Khalifa at the time, يعني Ja'far al-Mansur. Ja'far al-Mansur كان يقدمه. يعني it is said that Ja'far al-Mansur used to give him precedence over all of the other scholars. طيب. That's the level that he reached. Amr ibn Ubayd, did the Salaf now say, let's not refute him because he is someone who has a status? See, personalities, ikhwan. Nowadays, a person can get away with anything because this person has hundreds of thousands of followers, a million followers. Adi, ما في شيء. Because he has those followers, he can say whatever he wants. And no one can question this person. Amr ibn Ubayd reached that level. Yet, you all know what happened. The ulama, rahimahumullah ta'ala, refuted him. Shanna'u alayhi, raddu, يعني, and they refuted him. Asim al-Ahwal, he said that one day I was sitting with Qatada. طيب. And Qatada ذكر Amr ibn Ubayd was mentioned in the sitting. And Qatada وقع فيه, يعني he refuted him on the spot. Okay? فوقع فيه. Did he wait and say, listen, I'm going to wait. Let's let people disperse. I'm going to talk about him next time. لا. On the spot, he refuted him. And he spoke about him. فقلتُ عاصم الأحول, he said, لا أرى العلماء يقع بعضهم في بعض. The scholars, he says, I think that scholars shouldn't speak about each other. يعني he's basically saying, why are you speaking about it? يعني I think that the scholars shouldn't speak about each other. فقال له قتادة على سبيل التنكير. قتادة, he said, منكراً عليه, يعني يعني in a state of يعني إنكار عليه, يعني he was making إنكار of him, he was rebuking him. He says, يا أحول, أو أحول, ألا ترى أن الرجل إذا ابتدع فينبغي أن يذكر حتى يحذر. Do you not think that if a person commits a bid'ah, that this person should be refuted so that people, ماذا, so that people stay away from him? طيب. Simple قاعدة, simple ماذا, principle. That's the first example. The second example is Al-Harith Al-Muhasibi. Al-Harith Al-Muhasibi was someone who had ilm and had zuhd. Imam Ahmad even mentions this. In fact, one day Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala was sitting, يعني, he was listening to Al-Harith Al-Muhasibi giving an admonishment. And Imam Ahmad, he cried profusely. فَاشْتَدَّ بُكَاؤُهُ اشْتَدَّ, he cried profusely. And Imam Ahmad, this was in the house of Ismail al-Sarraj. So after he finished crying, he turned to Ismail al-Sarraj and he says, I have never seen anyone like this person. مَا رَأَيْتُ مِثْلَهُ. And I have never heard anything similar to this speech. طيب. In zuhd, يعني in zuhd. ولكن, however, أرى أن لا تجالسه. However, I think that you should not sit with him. He warned against him. Even after this. So did Imam Ahmad say, wow, this person is so eloquent. This person is this, this person is that. La. Ikhwani fillah, eloquence of the tongue isn't a license to commit innovations. Just because you're a person or a da'iyah يعني is eloquent when they speak, okay, doesn't mean that this person ماذا, is upon the haqq. How do we know if he's upon the haqq? If his speech conforms to قال الله قال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. If we take his speech and we measure their words with the words of the Sharia or with the Sharia itself, that's how we know. The next shubha, number 7, is they say Fulan so and so, يعني yes, he made a mistake. This is when they have no choice but to agree. They've been cornered. So they say Fulan so-and-so مخالفته صغيرة. His مخالفه is only small. He only committed one act of innovation. One thing only. طيب. So لا تستحق كل هذا الرد. All of these refutations and all of this رد, he doesn't deserve it. It's just one mistake, one error that he made. طيب. And why are you causing the people to become distracted from learning and from all of this but because of this one error, one mistake? طيب. Now, if this person, if the mistake is in a مسألة فرعية, مسألة يسوغ فيها الاجتهاد, then that makes sense. If this mistake is an issue, if this issue is an issue of خلاف in fiqh, مثلا, طيب, a person, for example, in matters of, for example, يعني, it could be, for example, the أصبع, يعني, should the person move their finger in the تشهد, or should they leave their finger still? Which one should they do? Or should they move their finger when they say اللهم صل على محمد عند التشهد or before the تشهد? طيب, so if it's a mas'ala issue where there is a khilaf between أهل السنة والجماعة, okay, then in this instance that makes sense and their kalam is absolutely صحيح and correct. طيب, but unfortunately هيهات لهم من ذلك, yeah, late, يعني unfortunately, yeah, late, if this was the reason why they said it. The reason what they mean by this, what they say is, what they mean is مسألة المسائل التي لا يسوغ فيها الاجتهاد, يعني in the issues in which there is no, it's not permissible to have any اجتهاد in these particular issues. طيب, these type of issues where اجتهاد isn't allowed, issues of عقيدة مثلا, one mistake in عقيدة is enough for that person to be advised. Firstly, we advise the person, of course, ننصحه, but نبين الخطأ, we have to clarify the error and we have to clarify the mistake. If he clarifies his own mistake, that's even better. Then no one has to do anything, alhamdulillah, that's good. هذا هو الإنصاف. But if he doesn't and he's مستمر على هذا and he's stubborn and he has عناد and he continues upon the mistake, then it is upon us, it is upon أهل السنة. What I mean, us, I don't mean مسكين مثلي, يعني it is upon the علماء of أهل السنة والجماعة to refute that خطأ and to refute this. The evidence of this is the statement of عبد الله بن مسعود mentioned by, narrated by Imam اللالكائي. He says يجيء قوم, الإمام ابن عبد الله بن مسعود, he says a people will come يتركون من السنة مثل هذا, يعني مثل الأنملة, فإن تركتموهم جاءوا بالطامة الكبرى. He says there will be a people who will abandon the sunnah, something equivalent to this, يعني something equivalent to the size of your يعني the size of your half a finger, أنملة, يعني something very minute, like your, يعني something very minute, يعني. And but if they are left, if they are left, طيب, جاءوا بطامة الكبرى, they will come with a calamity, with a major calamity, because البدع تبدأ صغيرة, innovation starts small, until if no one refutes it, no one speaks about it, ماذا, it becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. So مثلا a person may say يجوز الإنكار على ولاة الأمور, it is permissible to make inkar of the rulers, not to rebel against the rulers, they say, but to make inkar of the rulers, to mention their faults. It is permissible to mention the faults of the rulers. It is permissible to mention the mistakes of the rulers, but that doesn't mean I'm going to revolt. Okay, that's how it starts. طيب, and then the next day, no one, this person, خلاص, he got away with it. No one says anything. The next time he says, okay, now we can revolt in certain situations. When the ruler does this or that or that, we can revolt. But if they don't do this, we shouldn't revolt. And هكذا تتجاسر الأمر, things start to get worse. The next, Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah, he says that a person said to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, إنه يثقل علي أن أقول فلان كذا وفلان كذا. It is difficult for me to say that to speak about a particular person and say so and so is this and so and so is that. فقال الإمام أحمد, he said, إذا سكت أنت, if you remain silent, وسكت أنا, and I remain silent, فمتى يعرف الجاهل الصحيح من السقيم, when will the person who's ignorant know that which is authentic from that which is inauthentic? طيب, so الإمام أحمد is saying, يعني, that someone has to clarify the حق and the truth. And Ibn Taymiyyah رحمه الله تعالى, He says وكذلك بيان من غلط في رأي رآه في أمر الدين من المسائل العلمية والعملية. فهذا إذا تكلم فيه إذا تكلم فيه الإنسان بعلم وعدل وقصد النصيحة فالله تعالى يثيبه. He says that speaking and clarifying the mistake of a person who makes a mistake in this religion is something that is من المسائل العلمية والعملية. He says if a person speaks about this person, clarifies this mistake بعلم with knowledge وعدل with justice وقصد النصيحة and the intention is نصيحة for that person and نصيحة for the ummah, فالله تعالى يثيبه على ذلك. Allah عز وجل will reward this person for this. So Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah mentions the shurut. The conditions are when you're speaking about clarifying the mistake of the innovators, the mistake of a person who made an error, is that this person has to have ilm firstly. So the refutation has to be bi'ilm. It can't be some nonsense PDFs that basically they write. He said, she said, I dhahabtu, qasadtu, fa'altu. La. It has to be biqala laha qala rasuluhu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it has to be bi'ilmin, number one. Wa'adlin, it has to be also with justice. وقصد النصيحة, and it has to be ماذا? For the qasd and the intention has to be nasiha. The intention cannot be for you to get your own back. That is a tammatul kubra. This is a musibah, ikhwan. La budda an tatafaqqad niyatak. It can't be, the intention can't be that you're looking to get your own back on this. And also, ikhwan fillah, some people, especially the ghulat, this is a wasfun fil ghulat, more than the mumayyi'in, they get happy. You feel that they get happy when someone makes a mistake. يعني يفرحون يطيرون فرحا. We told you so. We spoke about this 50 years ago or something. 10 years ago, we spoke about this. We told you, أخي إخواني في الله, if subhanAllah, you speak about everyone, right? Of course, in certain situations, you're going to be correct. أليس كذلك? If you take a pebble now, a stone right now, right? And you throw that stone in amongst a crowd of people, right? And then it hits someone on the head. And then you say, shuft, I have good aim. I hit someone. This is إخواني في الله, the غلات. This is what they do. Okay? So it's كلام فاضي, إخوان. Don't be, لا تغتر بما يقولون. We told you about this person. It could be, wallahu a'lam, Allahu a'lam, that the reason that person that they spoke about 10 years ago, who was upon the haq, the reason why that person now has unfortunately fell into the traps of the shaitan and became a mumayyi', the reason could be, I'm not making justification here, but the reason could be because of the shidda that that person experienced, as you've learnt in the previous lecture, إخوان في الله. So أهل السنة والجماعة إخوان في الله لا يفرحون لخطأ المخطئ. لا يفرحون. They don't get happy because of a person sinning. Find me an ayah or a hadith where a person's status is elevated in the sight of Allah Azza wa Jal, or a person's enters Jannah, or a person's level in Jannah increases because of another Muslim falling into a sin. Find where does it say? يعني if this Muslim, let's call him Zayd, falls into a bid'ah and innovation, does that increase? I've advised them, they fall into an innovation. Does that mean that I am upon the haq even more so? لا. Why would I help the shaitan against my brother? This person is still my brother, akhi. So there has to be insaf. Even if that person is a jahil, and lahu lisanun tawil, and this person has a very sharp tongue, and they attack you for no reason whatsoever other than you refuting the people of innovation when you haven't said anything about them anywhere. Even if that's the case, you have to amsik alayka hadha, amsik lisanak. Don't defend yourself, but defend ماذا? The sunnah. And when you defend the sunnah, then as Al-Imam Al-Albani said, قُلْ كَلِمَتَكَ وَمْشِي. Defend the sunnah, refute what you have to refute and go. As for back and forths, يعني, unless they come with a new bid'ah, a new innovation, if they're saying the same thing, then you don't need to say it again. You don't need to have this back and forth, tit for tat, طيب, which the ghulat do. هذا يشغل الشباب. That's what distracts the shabab. So look at the ulama, Imam Ibn Baz, Imam Al-Albani, when they refute people, خلاص يمشون. They continue with teaching the lessons. The asl ikhwan fillah is not, we don't learn our religion through rudud, through refutations. Refutations are part of Islam. But have you heard of a talib ilm, a student of knowledge, starting with al-jarh wa ta'dil before they start with Surah al-Fatiha, before they even know how to recite the Quran or recite or learn the بديهيات العلم, some of the مسائل العلمية that are for صغار, يعني جرح وتعديل. It is not wajib upon you, it is not wajib upon us to know the stance of every single person, to know the موقف of every single masjid, every single مركز. لا, لا يجب علينا. ما أدري فلان فلان, what's فلان فلان, what do you say about him? يا أخي, I don't say anything, أخي. لا أدري عنه شيء. I have no idea who this person is. اتركني يا أخي. Leave me alone. So, إخواني في الله, this is something that we need to know. The next شبهة is قولهم بفقه الواقع وفقه المرحلة. So they say that we give دعوة based on the مرحلة that we're in right now, the situation that we're in, and we've covered this previously, that this is one of the بدع of the قطبية الإخوانية, an innovation innovated by Sayyid Qutb. Number 9 is they say that both, this is from the Qulat and the others, both of them, they say that, and the Mumayyin, they say that عندنا آلاف الأتباع, we have thousands of followers. طيب, and this shows that we are upon the haq, and that Allah وضع لنا القبول في الأرض, that Allah Azza wa Jalla has placed acceptance for us on the earth. We have all these hundreds of thousands of followers. أنت مسكين يا أخي, من عندك يا أخي. You have like 7-8 people coming to your lessons. I have ماذا? I have thousands of people coming to my lessons. I'm invited everywhere. Where are you invited? You're in your local masjid, in Masjid al-Nawawi. No one invites you anywhere, but we are invited everywhere. إخواني, I've heard this. يعني. This is, الله أعلم if this qualifies as a شبهة, but this is the situation that we're in. So, and everyone loves us. طيب, we can say to them, طيب, are you better than prophets and messengers? The answer is obviously going to be no. طيب, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًا شَيَاطِينَ الْإِنسِ وَالْجِنِّ يُوحِي بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ زُخْرُفَ الْقَوْلِ غُرُورًا. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and every prophet had an enemy from the shayateen al-insi wal-jinn. طيب, every prophet. So how on, يعني you're saying you have no enemies and everyone loves you, right? You cannot be better than prophets and messengers. Every single prophet has an enemy. And إخواني في الله, this is معروف. No one invites to tawheed and sunnah except that that person will have enemies. شاء أم أبا, أبدا. In fact, Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli, he says, إذا رضي عنك أهل البدع ففتش عن نفسك. If أهل البدع, if people of innovation are happy with you, then really you should be looking, you should be checking yourself. You should be finding out where you went wrong. The fact that the tablighi is happy with you, the sufi is happy with you, the khariji is happy with you, and the ikhwan is happy with you, that means, what are you inviting to? What is exactly is your da'wah? If everyone's happy with you, that means that there is la shak, there is a khalal in your da'wah. No, يعني you can't have qabool. يعني when al-qabool fi al-ard, acceptance is from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, not from the people of innovation, not from the people of batin, not from the ماذا, mushrikeen. Number 10 is they say that the Salafis, they don't know any, يعني they don't, oh, the only thing that they know is al-jarh wa-tasnif wal-kalam fi al-ashkhas. طيب, and they mention some evidences, they mention مثلا the kalam of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, where he says min al-qawa'id al-'azima allati hiya min jima' ad-din ta'lif al-qulub wa ijtima' al-kalimah wa islah dhat al-bayn. So they mention these statements of the scholars and they put them in the wrong context to confuse the layman, to confuse the young shab who says, oh, they've mentioned this qawl by Shaykh al-Islam al-Taymi, so it must be haq. This qawl is haq, but it's in the wrong context. Shaykh al-Islam, he says that from the qawa'id, from the major qawa'id and principles of this religion is ta'lif al-qulubi wa ijtima' al-kalima, is to unite the hearts and to come together, and islah dhat al-bayn, and to rectify people, يعني that which is between people. This is haq, and this is true. But is that in Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah himself refutes the people of innovation? Does he mean here that we should come together upon falsehood? Does he mean that we should sit and unite with the people of falsehood, with the people of innovation? La wallahi kalla. So when these people, when they say that Salafiyun, the Salafis only know jarh, kadhib, هذا كذب. Simple. The simple refutation is هذا كذب. السلفية is منهج علم. The only people, إخواني في الله, that teach and place importance in knowledge are who? The سلفيون أخي. Where have you seen the takfiri sitting down and learning, إخوان? The only thing that they sit down and read is the Independent and the Telegram and the Daily Mail. That's it. Have you ever seen them sitting down and learning مسائل علمية? أبداً. You don't. Where have you seen the إخوان is doing it? The Sururis try to do it sometimes, but even they get tired. They start a kitab, kitab al-tawheed. Salman al-Awda, when he used to teach al-aqid al-tahawiyya or some of the books of the Salaf, you know, he would, our ulama, they said that he would only do it for the first lesson. They say that the first lesson was like an hour or 2 hours long, where he would talk about so many different masail. The second lesson would be like half an hour. The third lesson would be like 5-10 minutes. And then he would close the book and talk about matters, يعني, more pressing matters in his eyes, which is political activism, how to overthrow this government, how to overthrow that government, how to go into that, يعني, how to infiltrate that hukuma, how to infiltrate this. So infiltration is part and parcel of the Ikhwani methodology. So what makes you think that they don't try to infiltrate the Salafis? What makes you think that doesn't happen? Of course it happens. They'll try to make themselves look like a Salafi, okay, in order to hunt down the Salafis one by one, get them to come to them, and then yabuthuna sumum, and then they will make them listen to their poison. Number 11 is, they would say that we have to change our manhaj in da'wah, so that our manhaj in da'wah has to be conformed to the time that we live in. And they say that wasa'il al-da'wah ijtihadiyya. So they say that the methods of da'wah are based on ijtihad, which is obviously incorrect. Wasa'il al-da'wah is tawqifiyya. Is ماذا tawqifiyya? And they've misunderstood some of the words of the ulama and the scholars. There are some scholars of Ahlus Sunnah wal-Jama'ah that say wasa'il al-da'wah ijtihadiyya. But what they mean by wasa'il al-da'wah ijtihadiyya is that they mean that the instruments of da'wah, يعني وسائط الدعوة, الأدوات الدعوة, such as the microphone, things that we use to give da'wah, such as the cassette player, videos, these are things that change based on the changing of the times and the changing of the eras and time, because يعني when microphones weren't around when the Prophet ﷺ was around, they weren't cassette players, all of this, right? And the best example to give is جمع القرآن. مثلا the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says إنا نحن نزلنا ذكرى وإنا له لحافظون. When the Prophet died صلى الله عليه وسلم, he didn't tell the Sahaba exactly how to protect and preserve the Mus'haf. So the Sahaba, they made ijtihad and they wrote down the Mus'haf and they put the dots in the right places. They created and then they compiled the Mus'haf and then they distributed it amongst the Ummah. So what they did was, the ulama, they class it as min al-masalih al-mursala, maslaha mursala. طيب? So this is wasa'it al-da'wah. As for wasa'il al-da'wah, the actual methods that we use in giving da'wah, from the khitab, khutab jum'ah, durus, lessons, al-kalam, al-wa'd, admonishments, then these are tawqifiyya. It has to be based upon the Quran and the Sunnah. طيب? And there's many evidences, because da'wah is ibadah, is an act of worship. And all acts of worship, as you know, has to be based upon two things, al-ikhlas wal-mutaba'a, sincerity and following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the proof of this is the hadith of Aisha, man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa rad, and man amila amala laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad, and other than this. And also, and the proof is that the Salaf, they rebuked and refuted the qassasin, storytellers. You know who storytellers are? We're not talking about the stories in the Quran and the Sunnah. We're talking about the stories that are ماذا, يعني that are ماذا, the stories basically that are يعني that they make up. So storytellers are people who just generally use stories to give da'wah. I did this one day. I was walking in the street and I saw this person, and this person did this and they did that, and that caused me to think about the creation of the heavens and the earth, مثلا. طيب? These are just stories. So the Salaf رضوان الله تعالى عليهم, they said, معاوية مثلا من قرة, he says, كنا إذا رأينا الرجل يقص علينا قلنا هذا صاحب السنة. Whenever if we saw a man giving qasas and stories, we would automatically class this person and label this person as a sahibu bid'ah. Sahibu bid'ah, نعم not sunnah. Sahibu bid'ah. We would class this person as a sahibu bid'ah, as a person of innovation. Also, at-tamthiliyat, the salaf, they would refute, they refuted a qawm or a people that used to give da'wah through tamthil, يعني through basically just acting. Through ماذا? Acting. Out scenarios. Also, the ulama, they refuted al-bay'a, al-bid'iyya, al-jama'iyya, what the ikhwan muslimin do, where they have bay'a, they pledge allegiance to a particular head, figurehead. So in UK, in the UK, for example, there's someone who they all, the people, the ikhwan is in the UK, have to pledge allegiance to him. Then he has to pledge allegiance to the one who is, the يعني, in their eyes, they have their own, they have their own like universe where they're the rulers of certain parts and territories. So the Ikhwan, they have their own map where basically each one thinks that he rules something. So the one that rules Europe, subhanAllah, and they go and they pledge allegiance to him. Okay, and then he has to pledge allegiance to the one in Africa. And then there's the one supreme leader. Everyone has to everyone has to pledge allegiance to him. So this, we're laughing, Ikhwan, but this actually happens. This matter happens. And this is known as al-bay'a al-bid'iyya. So the ulama refuted this, and they said that this is ماذا a bid'a. And when their logic is that we are doing just tanzeem, we're basically trying to organize ourselves in da'wah. But go and teach and organize yourselves. You don't have to, subhanAllah, pledge allegiance to this person. يعني أبايعك على السمع والطاعة على الكتاب والسنة. إيش الكلام هذا؟ يعني that's only for the ruler. That's only matter for the ruler. Also, from the number 11 is, يعني this has been covered in the previous lecture. يعني إذا لم تبدع المبتدع فأنت مبتدع. طيب. If you don't make تبديع of the مبتدع, then you're a مبتدع. طيب. إذا صليت في مسجد كذا فأنت مبتدع. If you go and pray in that masjid, you're أنت منهم. You're a مبتدع. طيب. So this is the bid'ah of imtihan al-nas bin-nas, testing people with other people. And this has been covered profusely and in detail by Sheikh Sa'id in the previous lecture. If you want to go read more about this particular mas'ala, go back to Majmu' al-Fatawa, volume 3, page 415. Okay, Sheikh Sa'id Taymi mentions this bid'ah. And go back to volume 20, page 164. Also, the final shubha, I'm going to conclude with this, is their lack of differentiation between al-masail al-khilafiyya wal-masail al-qat'iyya. The fact, and this is both the ghulat and the mumayyi'in fall into this. So their lack of differentiation, they cannot distinguish between a mas'ala, an issue of khilaf, where khilaf is allowed in this particular issue, and another issue where there is no khilaf is allowed in this issue. It's a qat'iyya. You have to, the opinion is one, the only, the haq, يعني the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the khilaf is between Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah and the people of innovation. So the first masail al-khilafiyya, the khilaf is between Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So whichever qawl you take, no one can refute you for it, right? Unless it's a naqd ilmi, يعني a knowledge-based criticism, okay? Which is another bab. And the other khilaf, al-masail al-qat'iyya, are masail issues where the difference of opinion is between Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah and Ahlul Bid'ah wal Furqah. So they can't differentiate between the two. How so? So, مثلا, the ghulat, okay, the ghulat, those people who make jarh bidun ay mubarrir shar'i, the ghulat, they make jarh and they criticize and remove a person from the fold of the sunnah, طيب, in issues in which the khilaf is allowed, in issues where khilaf is allowed, or in issues in which they shouldn't anyway remove someone from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. طيب, so an example of this is, they think this person, if someone believes that so and so is an innovator, طيب, you can't go around testing people and saying also you have to take my opinion, otherwise you're also a mubtadi'. طيب, that's just one example. So the ghulat, they can't differentiate between the two. And as for the mumayyi'een, so the ghulat, they will remove someone from the Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah because of mistakes in al-masail al-far'iyya, in masail al-khilafiyya. As for the mumayyi'een, they will remove some, they will include everyone in the sunnah. They will include anyone who makes mistakes in aqidah upon the sunnah. You see the difference? So both of them are mada? Batil. The ghulat and the mumayyi'een. So the ghulat, only a few people are upon the sunnah. Okay? The mumayyi'een, everyone is upon the sunnah. طيب? So there is no dhabt in the bat. And the ghulat, they have removed from the sunnah people who deserve to be from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And the mumayyi'un, they have included in Ahl Sunnah people who are not deserving to be given that title. طيب؟ والله تعالى أعلم صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إخواني في الله أختم بنصيحة. I advise all of you, إخواني في الله. And I know you've heard this many times, طيب, from your teachers. I advise you, إخواني في الله, to seek knowledge. طيب, you have heard the kalam of the of أهل العلم, the people of knowledge. طيب, you don't need to, all you have to do is refer back to that the ulama and the people of knowledge. Seek knowledge. تعلموا. It is in this day and age, the only way to remain upon istiqama is طلب العلم. فاستقم كما أمرت. Allah says, فاستقم, be steadfast, fast as you have been commanded. طيب. So العلم العلم العلم. Seek knowledge, إخواني في الله. And لا تتعصب للآراء والرجال. Don't have any تعصب. Defend the ulama and the scholars. Go back to their speech. Go back to what they said. Okay. If there is any غموض, if there is something that we do not know, فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون. We go back to the ulama and the scholars. إن كنتم لا تعلمون. If there is any ambiguity, we go back to the ulama. And also know that السلفية والسنة is a دعوة based upon رحمة. The fact that it's based upon رحمة doesn't mean that there is no that there is no refutation, there is no رد على المخالف. طيب, there is no شدة في موطنه, there is no the harshness in the right places. But the أصل is ما كان الرفق في شيء إلا زانه وما نزع عن شيء إلا شانه. Rifq and gentleness is not placed into something except that it beautifies it. So الأصل هو الرفق. That's the أصل. طيب, and we have to لابد أن نتحلى بهذا. And the only way for us to attain the highest stations in Jannah, to become firmly grounded in seeking knowledge is an-niyya as-saliha. This is very important, Ikhwan. An-niyya as-saliha. Correcting your intention. Why you seek knowledge? Why are you sitting here for hours on end reading these books? Sheikh Abbad, حفظه الله تعالى, would say that دليل الإخلاص المواصل على طلب العلم. دليل الإخلاص, a sign of a person, a student of knowledge, is إخلاص and sincerity, is that student continues to seek knowledge for years and years, doesn't stop, no matter what's happening around him, the fitna, continues to seek knowledge. So an-niyya is very important, the niyya, Ikhwan. And rectifying the heart. The Prophet says, إِذَا صَلُحَتْ إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةِ إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ وَإِذَا فَسُدَتْ فَسَدُ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ أَلَا وَهِي الْقَلْبِ. To rectify the qalb and the heart, making sure that the heart is something that we can rectify. And I advise you, Ikhwan fi Allah, to read for the rectification of the heart and things to do with the heart and the istiqama, read Adda' wa Dawa' Ibn al-Qayyim. I advise you to read that book continuously. If you're giving even khutbah jum'ah, base your khutbah around that book, the disease and the cure. Okay, when it comes, and rectifying the heart and rectifying that which is between us and Allah Azza wa Jal, if we rectify this, then Allah Azza wa Jal will rectify all our affairs. So the reason why people fall into all of these mistakes, at-tamiyah, al-ghulu, mostly, some of the ulama, they say it's because of the heart, ikhwan, ikhlas, lack of sincerity, that everyone wants to al-intisaru bin nafs, everyone wants to aid and give victory to himself. So it's nothing to do with the sunnah or al-kitab or sunnah. The kitab and the sunnah are just being used, are victims. Everyone wants al-intisaru lin nafs. I am the one who's upon the haqq, everyone is upon the batil. If someone attacks him one day, then he wants to get his own back. So he plots and he schemes and he waits for that person to make a mistake. The moment he makes a mistake, khalas, he jumps on the bandwagon. لا أبدا. Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah, ikhwan, from their insaf and their justice and their adl, is that they will not lie against their khusum. They don't lie against the person who is refuting them. They don't lie, even though they have the opportunity to do so, even though that person may be lying against them, may be saying things that they are free of, but they still, لا يعاملون بالمثل. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, أَدِّ الْأَمَانَةَ إِلَى مَنِ اتَّمَنَكَ وَلَا تَخُنْ مَنْ خَانَكَ. Fulfill your responsibility to the one who has entrusted you. طيب. And do not betray the one who has betrayed you. So if someone betrays you, that doesn't give you the right to go and betray them. If someone oppresses you, that doesn't give you the right to oppress them. Sahih, you advise them. تنصحهم. You clarify your position. But you don't go overboard and you don't oppress him. Inshallah ta'ala, bin Allah ta'ala, jazakum Allah khair, wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
وقل رب زدني علما.